I know how to take care of me bum, and I know how to take care of me aunt. I know how to take care of me thyroid, and I know how to take care of me cholesterol, because sometimes that can be a little bit high, especially the one that's not so good. The other one that's good is sometimes a little bit low. So I know how to take care of that. And I know how to take care of me osteoporosis. But how on earth do I take care of me teeth?
Irene, I'm one of the 9 out of 10 dentists who recommends this Ducodyne toothpaste, perfect for your oral health needs.
Well, thank you. Now that I use Ducodyne, I know how to take care of me teeth and me bum.
Fresh. Hello, 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 hello. Welcome to the super summer celebration of all things wonderful on the Dukey Radio Show. We are back, don't call it a comeback, with me in the studio, Sylvia Silversmith.
Hello, peeps.
And Marsha MacDonald.
Yeah, what up, summer celebration people?
Irene kicked off our episode with something a bit different. Normally she sings a song for us.
Yeah.
Or goes into one about something that has upset her. This seemed to be about maintenance. Her bum, her heart, addressing her osteoporosis, addressing other concerns, and most of all, addressing her teeth.
Yeah, Dukey, and I think I have something to do with this.
Tell me more.
Well, I've been getting a little preoccupied with a toothpaste commercial lately. Right?
Right.
It's been shown a lot, and it's the summer, and I've had some time off. And what do you do when you got time off?
You watch dodgy telly.
You put crappy television on.
Fair enough.
Okay? And me and Sylvia have been watching a lot of crappy stuff.
Nothing wrong with that.
I've discovered a show called Miss Fisher's Mysteries.
Oh, is that the Australian Father Brown?
I've discovered this, right. Dukey, and I'm torturing Marsha with it.
It's set in the 1920s.
Yes.
She's posh and wonderful.
Yes.
She wears amazing outfits.
Oh.
She solves crimes.
Dukey, it's like... Yes, I do love Father Brown. I do love Father Brown mainly because I love Father Brown, but I also love his sidekicks.
Yes.
If nobody knows Father Brown, look it up because you need to watch it because Bunty is amazing. And Mrs. McCarthy is amazing.
Yes.
And I think because I've seen all the Father Browns like 16 times now, I went looking for something else.
Right. Father Brown, 7 series or so?
Yes, I've seen them all.
Roughly.
I've got them. I know who the murderers are in all of them. And it's been a rough year, Dukey, so I'm just looking for we're all looking for escape.
Comfort television.
Yes. So, you know, a nice cozy murder here and there. You know, and it's the person always deserved it. So, you know, it's all that kind of, you know, black and white, you know, well, they're dead, but they deserved it. So it's all easy answers and you don't have to think too much. So I think I was getting withdrawal. So I came across Miss Fisher. Mm. Now, her sidekicks are really not very good. But she's amazing. Her outfits.
Right.
Oh, the swooning. The swooning.
It's a crime to not own these 1920s Dukey. Ensembles.
Because, you know, everybody has an era. I think yours is in 1968, right? Where you love the clothes. You love the women's clothes in particular.
Yes.
Of the 60s.
I do.
Mine is the 20s and early 30s, where I love the clothes. The men's clothes, the women's clothes, and her outfits. So anytime that she runs towards, Miss Fisher, runs towards somebody who's bleeding, I'm screaming out, watch the outfit, watch the outfit, don't get blood on the outfit. She actually is doing that, Dukey.
Right, oh dear.
So
So in between the this wonderful program,
yeah. So yeah, is an we're watching a lot of
has captivated
the Alibi Channel. There are other channels, right? But the Alibi, yeah, the Alibi Channel. I kind of like Risley and Isles,
right?
Because she's just like a lesbian. I think she's a lesbian. I've not seen that many of them, but she's a lesbian. She's just cool, and she knows how to handle crimes, and she knows how to solve them. And she can stand up against all these other, you know, male policemen. Right?
I like the sounds of this woman.
Yeah, yeah, she's really cool. She didn't have the outfit. Sorry, Sylv, but she's cool. Anyway, okay, so you get the idea. We're watching a lot of television
yes.
around our house.
So it's, let me get this. Trash telly, toothpaste.
Trash telly and toothpaste. And this ad keeps coming on that's irritating me, okay? And then I realized that Oral-B had the same theme in their ads for what must be a number of years now.
Mm.
And it's always some woman who's in her kind of early 30s who's attractive without being intimidating,
mm.
right? And she's always utterly, utterly baffled as to how to take care of her teeth. And I only just noticed it, like, why is she so baffled? I don't get it.
Here is the advert you speak of.
Yes.
Hips.
Heart.
I know how to keep my body healthy, but how do you keep your mouth healthy?
My dentist said,
try Oral-B Pro Expert.
Oral-B toothpaste.
It's actually the one I use myself.
I didn't even know Oral-B made a toothpaste.
Oral-B Pro Expert, the number one toothpaste most used by dentists in the UK.
I tried it and my whole mouth feels healthier and stronger.
For a healthier mouth and stronger teeth starting from day one, Oral-B, brush like a pro.
That is the 2017 Oral-B TV advert featuring Lorna Nixon Brown.
Though that's been running since 2017?
Yes, they're still showing it.
Oh, I thought it'd just come out.
Mm.
They've had other ones, though, because I know there have been different women.
Basically, it's the same woman, only with slightly different hair. And,
yeah, basically, you know, it's always the same kind of woman. And the thing that I don't get...
It's the Pippa Evans past Dukey radio show guest type.
She'd be great in that. Mm. Yeah. Like, you know, really, really nice looking woman. And
wonderful teeth.
Wonderful teeth. Well, see, there's the rub. Because I don't understand. Because I look at these women and this woman in this latest advert.
Bum. Heart.
Yeah.
But what do I do about my teeth?
Why?
Her teeth are extraordinary.
Yeah. Why are you so baffled?
It would make more sense if she had a great bum and she goes bum, and you see her working out.
She does have a great bum, yeah.
And you know, she goes heart, and then, you know, a cardiologist goes well done.
Yeah.
But she opens her mouth wide and suddenly you see these really nasty gnashes.
Yeah, see, I don't understand. Like, you clearly know something about taking care of your teeth.
Mm.
So why do you seem so incredibly baffled about it?
I'm like, confused.
Just like, shouldn't she look like that guy? Who's that guy in the band who's famous for bad teeth?
Shane McGowan from The Pogues.
Okay, is that his name?
Yes.
Okay, so some guy
who famously only recently, in the last couple of years, he must have been in his late 50s, had implants.
Oh yeah, I watched that documentary.
And a dentist who happens to be a Pogues fan did the whole procedure for free.
Like, got his whole mouth.
Mm.
So he went from having these really, really gnarly brown stumps.
From a very young age.
Yes.
If you look at photos of the Pogues, you know, from the 1980s onwards, his teeth were really, really, really grim.
Yes. He, like... Didn't he say in that doc that he'd never brushed his teeth?
Mm.
Yeah, so they were, like, not nice at all. If it was that guy in the commercials, you kind of understand it. You go, yeah, that guy clearly doesn't know how to take care of his teeth.
I mean, like, it's Shane, despite his lifestyle, he's still alive. And his version could be, you know, liver, waistline, teeth, whoa! Hello, Shane, you need to try this. But, you Lorna Nixon Brown, she's got a Hollywood smile.
I don't know that I would argue that Shane McGowan knows how to look after his liver.
Well,
seeing as he's also famous for being a raging alcoholic.
About 15 years or so ago, I was at the Filthy McNasty pub, Filthy McNasties.
Yes.
And I'd had a little bit of Irish courage in me, and I saw the man himself sat on his own.
Okay.
I felt duty-bound to say hello, and I did.
Wow.
And instead of doing the whole, love your work, I just asked him, Shane, what are you working on? What's new? What's next? And he just pointed to the pint of Guinness that he had in front of him and some kind of a chaser, nodded his head and said absolutely nothing else. And I left him alone.
Wow.
But he was working on those bad boys.
I hope so. He's one of those, I've heard the music, especially that they always play that Christmas song where he's singing with a woman.
Yes.
Right.
The late Ms. McCall.
Yeah. And I just, every Christmas you hear that song everywhere. And I'm just like, I don't get them. I don't get it. It's just one of those things that I think, no matter how long I live here, that will always be a British step too far.
An Anglo-Irish step too far.
Okay, yeah. So I just don't. Do you get it, Sylv? Yeah, I can't say that I do. It's just one of those things that I just think, yeah, I guess you had to be there. I don't get it. I don't, because some people really revere him.
Absolutely. I mean, lyrically, he's, very, very, highly regarded and deservedly so.
Yeah, it's the deservedly that I don't get.
And also there's, an element of the tortured genius that, with this talent, comes pain. And with pain comes a hell of a lot of alcohol abuse.
I think he's like the Irish equivalent of Jimmy Buffett. Like, unless you're American, like steeped in Americana, you won't get Jimmy Buffett.
But that said, the Pogues have a huge fan base in the Americas. That particular track you were talking about, Christmas in New York, it features Matt Dillon in the video. It was filmed in New York.
Does it?
Yes.
Oh. See, I have to switch it off because I just don't like it. I'm really sorry, I don't.
Yeah, ultimately, and then there are those American or sometimes Irish American outfits like Flogging Molly, who do, Celtic-infused rock or punk. And, very much keeping the tradition of the Pogues alive.
Yeah, I don't get it.
And, yes.
Does he have a partner, like a life partner?
A long, long-term partner, yes.
Wow. So, somebody has decided, when they, met for the first time...
Mm.
And decided to go on a date or whatever, or hook up or whatever. She decided, I'm good with the stumps. That's fine.
Mm.
Because he's such a genius or whatever that I can overlook that.
Such a lovely man, such a caring character. I mean, it's in interviews, she has said that he is a challenging man to deal with, but.
So. Okay, so that to me is even more confusing. Like, he's a challenging guy, and he's got these brown stumps, and that's okay. I'm going to overlook all of that because, boy, I don't know.
He's a genius.
He's a genius.
A little factoid about his implants. He had not one but two procedures. Did you know about this?
No.
When he had the first procedure, he deliberately asked for a full set of teeth that looked like they'd been lived in.
Yeah, I get that. You don't want those so white that they're blue kind of thing.
And then he wanted to look like a pirate. So he wanted to have, some, evidence of work having been done on the implant, if that makes sense.
Ah, okay.
He had them put in.
Right.
And he didn't like it and decided to go for the full Hollywood white as fuck option.
Oh, see? Wow.
And, he has wonderful hair. He is, facially, he has wonderful features.
Dukey.
And after the new teeth were put in, he looks like he could have been, the new proprietor of the local tavern in Hollyoaks. A program
which
steeps itself in having no stumps.
They definitely don't have stumps.
Wonderful teeth. on Hollyoaks.
In Hollyoaks, if people don't know, that is a British soap opera.
Set in the northwest of England, yes. In Chester, or just outside of Chester.
Where, unlike other British soap operas,
people are just incredibly attractive.
People are stunning.
And they have wonderful teeth.
Did you see this where they... What's his name? Brody? Mm. Was his it Stag Do? Oh,
the Hawaiian shirts.
No, they weren't wearing any shirts. They were wearing like grass skirts.
Oh, but I think they came in with Hawaiian shirts, okay. But those shirts were taken off.
Everybody in that Stag Do had...
12 packs.
Six packs. Yeah. So if you had a six pack, people were kind of thinking, you know, you might...
Yeah. So what? Check out this eight.
They were kind of looking at each other like, you know, you're letting yourself go a bit because I have a 12 pack. Mm. That's how good looking these people are on the show. So everybody in that show, they're all perfect, including their teeth. So they're not baffled about how dental hygiene. Yeah, I don't get. So for me, you know, being American, it's kind of like dental hygiene is kind of like paramount. Like it's pretty important stuff. I don't care how big of a genius you are. If you've got brown stumps, I'm going to struggle to be with you in a loving way. Mm. I mean, you know, friends, fine. To be with you in a loving way, I'm going to kind of have a hard time with that. I'm sorry if that makes me a terrible person. Oh, I'm just going to struggle a little bit.
So if Gail Ann Dorsey was to turn up, Marsha.
Yeah.
Ask you out.
Yeah.
And then suddenly she opens her mouth. Instantly, she has wonderful teeth. But let's just say, and she's American born.
Yeah.
But let's just say, you know, she opens the, you know, up her mouth and then suddenly you're faced with something that's akin to struggling. Your man from the Pogues.
Yeah, struggling.
You would decline
let's go get a coffee.
Advances.
You know, I'm not saying, but, you know, I'm just going to have to think about, do I want to advance this into a loving relationship? Maybe not.
Right.
I'm with her, Dukey.
Oh, dear.
Because you know that you kind of dip in and out of the Tour de France, don't you? That's only just ended a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah, I followed quite a bit of it this particular time.
One of the racers who's, I think he races for Ireland, even though he's from Birmingham, and he doesn't race for an English or Irish team, called Dan Martin. So he sounds like he's from Birmingham, but he's Irish, and he races for a team called UAE. Right. And he's standout, not just because he's a good cyclist, but because he interviews really well.
He's incredibly endearing.
Yes.
People, he seems like really, really sweet.
The journalists really go for him because he seems really nice and he'll give the journalist time. And he seems quite funny. He doesn't seem to up himself, which, you know, with some of the cyclists, they can be a little bit more challenging.
You get a lot of ego.
Yeah. So, and he lives in, I've only just recently found out from a friend who's really into cycling, that Dan Martin lives in Monaco.
So he's not short a few bob or three.
He's short of a few pounds. Mm. And this friend also told me, you know, don't feel sorry for Dan Martin because he's like millions in the bank.
Right.
Millions. And my first thought was, oh, why doesn't he do something with his teeth? Because it's not a hygiene problem.
No,
you know,
his
they're very
teeth,
white.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's just that
there's a lot of them.
There's a lot of, like, if you've seen The Grinch, like, they're not necessarily bad teeth. They're just a lot.
Too many teeth, too little mouth.
Yeah. So
too little a mouth.
Now I just look at Dan Martin. I just think, okay, so when you made your first million, and, you know, you buy a house and you buy the latest bicycle that you really want, even though that might be later.
He and his partner recently had a kid.
Yeah, you had a baby, so you put money away from college. You know, you might buy a flashy new car, you know, whatever, clothes, whatever. On your shopping list, did it not occur to you to say, like, okay, maybe I'll go to a special dentist and say, can you get rid of some of these? Because I don't need all of them.
Get rid of the ones that aren't essential.
Yeah, and then just maybe then you need some braces to bring the rest of them back together. Mm. Just to, you know. But then I thought, well, I'm American, and that's how Americans think.
But if he was to have braces, that's extra weight that he'd need to think about when he's cycling.
They do get quite ridiculous about stuff like that. But, you know, he could do it
veneers.
Off. You'd probably have to do something like that off season, right?
But then I thought they're removing teeth and they're removing weight.
Well, see?
So it's a balancing act.
I just think, okay, even with your first million, maybe you want to buy a really expensive house and a really expensive car. Your first 2 million, your first 3, 4, 5 million. By the time you get to maybe 6 million and you've bought like lots of stuff, do you not want to go to the dentist? Okay, now I've bought everything. Now I'm going to go have these, as you British call them, gnashers looked at. And that doesn't seem important to him. Whereas it would to Marcia and I. It would be very important.
I've got a confession about the Oral-B advert.
Yes.
And I need to give a little bit of a background to this. Over the last couple of weeks, I've been watching a lot of Netflix.
And, oh, Dukey.
And
Orange is the New Black.
I've been watching the latest series of Orange is the New Black. I've been watching Glow. And I don't know whether or not my brain's filter is different. But in the Oral-B advert, doesn't it seem as though the dentist is flirting with Lorna Nixon Brown?
Dukey, I know what you mean.
Thank God. Really?
Well,
Are you just being polite?
No, because I'm thinking that the doesn't the dentist like kind of look a little like a little winky winky with her?
It's like, oh, I happen to use the same toothpaste myself.
That's it. She says, I'm gonna let you in on what
I personally use. Yeah.
Yeah, like I don't tell any other patients about this. I tell you.
Yes. This is a personal... It's a boundary that's being crossed. She's revealing stuff about herself.
Yeah.
Yeah. I happen to use it as well.
So...
Maybe you can come to my flat and...
You can stretch that out a little bit to maybe we can go talk about this over some white foods.
Yes.
Okay?
Mm.
So, you know, white foods because... Maybe she's just done a little whitening treatment on her and she doesn't want to, you know, you have to eat white foods for a little while, I guess. Maybe, and I can talk you through, you know, I can walk you through the whole dental hygiene
at her
process.
At her flat afterwards.
Because why is she so bad? You know, isn't it? Why is she so confused? Isn't it like brush and floss?
Well, exactly.
Brush and floss.
There are other products as well. Do you remember the adverts at Orbit chewing gum? You know, 9 out of 10 dentists who have patients who chew gum recommend Orbit.
Okay, yeah, but that's an add-on.
But I think the idea being that I don't chew gum. Maybe you
Sylvia,
should.
Sylvia, you don't chew gum, do you?
I don't.
Okay, so we all
somebody
seem to...
Somebody gives me some. I don't want to be rude and sometimes I'll have it, but I won't go out of
you
my
have
way
gum
to purchase
because
it.
Because you don't want to be rude? What's wrong with saying no thanks?
No, often that happens when I'm on the road and I could use a little bit of freshening up. You know, a little bit of minty goodness when
but
I've had an
eight-hour
drive. No, it isn't essential. But the Orbit adverts would you know, and I'm sure there are other makes of chewing gum that you know provide the same kind of protection. The notion being that after you've had a meal, you chew the sugar-free gum, and then that your saliva creates enzymes, the enzymes break stuff down, and then, you know, yes.
So your acid isn't eroding your teeth.
Exactly. It's just,
teeth.
Yeah, it's part of your dental care.
All right. So none of us are baffled, right?
No.
A lot of people in this world were raised, you know, brush and floss.
Mm.
Okay, so not Shane McGowan. I'm not saying everybody in the world. I'm saying a lot of people in the world brush and floss. That's what you got to do, right? Maybe some mouthwash, but it's not essential. And in fact, I don't think it's all that great for you, mouthwash. My dentist once told me that it's not that great for you.
Mm.
Okay, so... Brush and floss. Why? What is she so confused about?
But also her teeth look amazing.
And yeah.
Even when she goes to the dentist. I wish mine looked as white as that.
She's clearly doing something right.
Mm.
That's like...
I think the dentist will agree.
That's like Dan Martin. Okay, to come back to the cyclists. Mm. Or any of the elite athletes in the sport of cycling or any other sport. That's like them going to their doctor and going, I don't know how to stay physically fit.
Yeah.
And it's like, well, you just cycled up the Alps for 3 weeks. You clearly are doing it right. Okay, that's how you stay, you know, you personally stay fit. Clearly, you're one of the fittest human beings in the world. So the doctor should be asking Dan Martin, you tell me and I'll pass it on. So like the dentist should be asking Lorna, what's her name? how do you keep your teeth so good? Because then I can pass it on to my other patients. Exactly. Except Dukey.
Yes.
I have a confession. After all this. Okay.
I'm all ears.
So, you want to know what me and Silver are doing tonight?
What?
And you're welcome to join us.
Wait, it's a confession and I'm now an invited guest.
Yeah, so you can come
you're
over.
You're confessing to something and I've been invited to take part. Should I guess inquire further? This scares me.
No, okay. So you can, because I don't think you know Miss Fisher, right? I personally am not a fan that much. I mean, I think the show is kind of dumb. But
I have seen a trailer. I've not actually watched a single episode.
Okay, so this is what we're going to do tonight.
I do like Father Brown, though.
Okay. I don't know what that is, but anyway.
Right.
Is that one of those mystery shows? Oh, yeah. That's what Sylv watches with a priest who solves crimes.
Yeah, Mark Williams, who is famous for The Fast Show.
Yeah, I don't know that. So, Miss Fisher, okay, so we're going to watch Miss Fisher tonight, I guess, because there's 198 episodes that Sylvia hasn't seen, right? And I bought some teeth whitening.
Oh.
Okay.
Oral-B?
No, it's not, actually. I had to think there for a second. No, it's not Oral-B. It's another kind, and it was on sale, and it's the trays. Right? So you get this tooth tray and you stick it over your teeth and you leave it in there for 20 minutes. And I guess the packet comes with 8 trays, so you need to do top and bottom, right? And so there's 8, so 2, 4, 6. So there's plenty for all of us, plus 2 more. And she and Sylvia and I are going to put a couple of trays in and leave them in while we watch Miss Fisher. Do you want to join us?
I'll do that, yes.
All right. So
count me
teeth whitening party. So, because I think that these commercials must have got inside my head.
Clearly.
Because yesterday I had to go to the pharmacy to just get whatever stuff that people tend to buy in the pharmacy.
And your feet took you there.
My feet took me to the dental aisle, even though I didn't need anything from the dental aisle. Well. And I found myself buying a teeth whitening kit.
My word.
And I think it's because it got in my head, right? So, and it was on sale because they tend to be pretty expensive. I don't think it was that. I don't think it was that. I don't think it's the Oral-B advert. I don't think it's that.
What do you think it is?
Yeah, what do you think it is? I think it's RuPaul.
RuPaul?
Yes. I think it's
sashay away.
I think it's one of the queens. One of the queens went on about Crest whitening strips.
Oh, yes, and ended up doing adverts for them. This is a wonderful, bit of progress in terms of advertising. To have a drag queen who looks absolutely amazing.
And I can't remember
advertising, a dental product, and deservedly so.
I can't remember who. I'm not sure whether it was Bob the Drag Queen.
Bob the Drag Queen does have amazing teeth.
Well, they all have amazing teeth. And
there
and
are a few exceptions.
I don't like the strips, though, because I feel like I've never tried any of this stuff, but I feel like they won't get in the little cracks. So I may have mentioned it to you, Martha, and I think that's what is in your subconscious.
So RuPaul.
You know, when you watch Drag Race, you start to think, maybe I could make a little bit more effort. You know, because these queens, what they go through to look amazing, I just think, you know, yeah, I could make, you know, maybe a bit more effort. And yeah, I think you're right. I think that's what sank into my subconscious. And we're having a teeth whitening party. Although Sunday night tends to be takeaway night, so I'm not really sure where that's going to fit in.
Maybe we'll do it after we have the takeaway.
Yeah, because you got to brush first.
Right, okay.
So, I was thinking about this in the pharmacy yesterday. I was like, well, where does like pizza or Chinese or Tex-Mex fit in? I guess we'll have to have dinner, and then we can all... So bring your toothbrush. We'll have to brush, and then we stick the trays in.
It just dawned on me that when you mentioned these trays, I asked you if it, you know, is an Oral-B product. And in the advert, that we've been analysing.
Yeah.
Alorna Nixon Brown, at the end of it, you know, says something along the lines of, you know, oh, I had no idea Oral-B did toothpaste.
Well, see, Dukey...
You know, is that exactly a shocking finding?
That's the other thing that really pisses me off, because, A, you're completely baffled as to how to take care of your teeth. You're utterly, utterly confused. Like, you... But even though you have perfect teeth. And then, you're utterly, utterly bowled over by the fact that a company that calls itself Oral-B has gone the extra step away from whatever the hell else they do, floss or
the
mouthwash.
The little implements that you put on your electric toothbrush.
Yeah, yeah, the toothbrush heads.
Yeah.
Away from that, oh my God!
So, whoa,
they branched out
into
toothpaste!
No idea.
Okay.
Totally surprising.
They didn't start selling guitars.
No.
You don't have an Oral-B guitar, do you? No.
No.
They thought, okay, we do floss, we do toothbrush heads, we do mouthwash. Hey, you know what might be interesting? It might be good if we sold toothpaste.
Mm.
Why is she so stymied by this? Why? I think it's anti-feminist. Like, why is she so stupid about dental stuff? None of these ads. Do you see a man?
No.
No. Do you see Shane McGowan going, oh my God, I have no idea how to take care of my teeth? Which would be fitting. There are. Why are these women so baffled? I think it bugs me. That's what I'm saying.
It bugs me as well.
There's a lot of other stuff in the world that bugs me more.
Mm.
It's just that it bugs me. That's what I'm saying.
Lorna Nixon Brown, you got some splaining to do. Isn't that an American reference to television? Isn't that like...
That's how I Love Lucy.
I Love Lucy.
Yeah.
Right.
Which, you know, if you're talking feminism, you know, that's going to take us down a whole other road, Dukey.
I heard that being brandished on an American podcast. I thought...
Yes, it's ripe for parody. So
this is quite an old... Doesn't that show date back to the 60s?
Oh, it's black and white.
Oh,
I mean,
right.
It's before my time.
Right.
But you can't be American and not grow, you know, see I Love Lucy. Dukey, are you
so
coming...
So glad I used that.
Are you coming over for whitening party tonight?
I'm there.
And that's not like a racist thing. You're going to come over to get whiter?
I am rife for whitening.
Let's do it.
Let's do it.
Bring it on.
Yeah, boy, gonna analyze this. Yeah, boy, gonna analyze this. Yeah, boy, gonna analyze this. Analyze this. Analyze this.
Yes, who's the next patient? I'm ready to do the analysis.
It's the long-awaited return of Analyze This. And Marsha, Sylvia, you are here to help me. And this particular track has been chosen for two reasons. Number one, we were having a chat, the three of us, about the use of the number age 17 in popular music.
Yeah.
And that happened in tandem with the anniversary, the 20th anniversary of the Sugababes' first single, and news of their reunion. And that then got us talking about a solo offering that one of the original members of Sugababes, Mutya, put out a couple of years ago, which uses the number 17.
I love this song. Really, really hard.
It's a Groove Armada featuring Mutya, one of the members.
I don't think it's fair. I just noticed that because I don't think it's fair to say featuring. Because
Mutya featuring Groove Armada.
Yeah, shouldn't it be Mutya featuring Groove Armada? I mean, or just like Mutya with Groove Armada.
This is Song for Mutya.
Hey!
I really, really love this song hard. Really, really hard. And I love the Sugababes really hard. Super duper hard.
Indeed.
And so I listened to this. It's on my Spotify. And I listen to it quite a lot in when I'm working out in the gym. And I just, sometimes the lyrics just baffle me slightly.
Mm.
Like one of those women who are baffled about oral hygiene.
True.
Like the same, and not just so baffled, but I kind of worry about Mutya a little bit in this song.
Well, indeed. I'm a new convert to the track. I only heard it recently.
You're a huge Sugababes fan, though, aren't you?
I think they're great. I always imagine that I'm the bloke that they're singing about who has done them wrong.
What, that they're really pissed off at? Yeah. Really? Have you done something to hack them off? Like, yeah, what? You know, they do have a lot of songs about being pissed off with men.
Yes.
Are you the guy?
I am the guy.
What have you done to them? Like, you didn't return their phone calls?
Yeah, basically, yeah. And I've done some crazy shit as
you,
well.
You ghosted them?
Yes.
Is that what you did, Dukey?
I looked at them the wrong way.
I think they're wonderful. I've loved them since they came out. And I don't care which iteration there are. Like, I love the original lineup. I also love Heidi. I loved Amel when she came along. Mm. I just love them all.
I mean, they're a bit like Menudo in the sense that, you know, members have come and gone.
Yes, and I love the stories about them. I love, like, I heard, like, one of them said that Keisha used to turn up her vocals in when they were recording, which I just think is just fantastic story. I just think that they all look, you know, like they could whoop your ass if they wanted to.
Particularly my ass.
Particularly your ass. But they could look really amazing while they were doing it, like not even break a nail or get a hair out of place. I love that. I love them all. And I love their songs.
Some exceptionally catchy tunes.
And really great tunes. I think this is one of them.
Which is, well, this being not a Sugababes song,
no,
but a Mutya.
It's a Mutya single, solo offering.
Yes. And the number 17, which in this particular case denotes a length of time, 17 months, is really at the foundation of the protagonist's struggle.
Well, see, that's what first caught my ear, because I've been listening to this song. I think this song came out in 2007.
Right.
And I've been a big fan of it since then. And I only just recently got on Spotify. So, and I was just thinking about songs that I really love that I want to have on my Spotify. And this was one of them. So I had it in my earphones. And she says, "You're gone now, I feel fine. 17 months, I feel fine. What about you? I bet you've been crying. I bet you've been going around town lying."
I mean, she's clearly had a split, and a very
yes.
painful split.
So she's saying that it's been 17 months since they split up, and she feels fine. And she's guessing that maybe he's not feeling so fine, and that he's going around telling lies about their relationship.
Mm.
And then she's driving along. She's feeling fine. She's listening to Prince, who's singing Hot Thing to her, and she knows every line. And I think that's great.
Who doesn't love Prince?
Who's not driving around, maybe on a summer's afternoon, listening to Prince and feeling good? Because why wouldn't you be feeling good if you're listening to Prince, right? So all so far is good, except that the ex pulls up to her and he's got his new girlfriend in the
car. Ouch. Ouch.
And then she says, "Sat there with some new girl. What is this? Don't panic, panic, Mutya. Don't drive erratic." So that's good, because she's thinking about safety.
Which is really, really important. I mean, she's aware that she's stressed out and that, you know, panic could cause her to drive erratically.
Okay, so that might be difficult. You see your ex with his new girlfriend, but you're still thinking, "I need to keep my eyes on the road. I don't want to hurt myself or anybody else." So that's good.
She's embraced every aspect of the highway code.
Yes, so that's good. I respect that. And then she says, "That's who has replaced me. What a diss. Don't panic, panic. Don't act too manic, manic." Now, what made me wonder when I really tuned into these lyrics was I started to think, okay, wait a minute. You broke up 17 months ago.
Mm.
So that's really close to being a year and a half.
It is.
So I'm worried for Mutya that she's still so upset about this. Because a year and a half's quite a long time to be broken up.
Indeed. And I think there's a false sense of security, possibly an element of her being delusional. You know, at the beginning, when she feels that he's the one that's not coping, that he's been crying, that he's going around town lying.
Yeah.
But then as soon as he turns up with his new love,
then she's not really feeling so fine.
Then the shit hits the fan for poor Mutya.
And it's kind of like, okay, so he's got a new girlfriend. You've been broken up for nearly a year and a half. Did you expect him to join a monastic order?
Yeah, quite possibly.
So I can understand where you're feeling good and then all of a sudden you've got a reminder of what seems to have been quite a painful breakup, maybe for both of them.
Certainly.
So I can see like that bums you out. So I do understand that. I just think if I was her friend, I would say to her, you know, it's been a year and a half. You're a gorgeous girl. You're a gorgeous woman. And, you know, you're really talented. You've got nice, sassy attitude. You're not going to have a problem finding another person.
Certainly not.
So, and then the song goes on. And then I get more confused.
Oh, well, indeed.
So then, you know, she says it's a surefire way to ruin my day. Just as soon as I'm on top of my life, there you are again. So it kind of suggests that she's seeing him more than this one time. So she's seeing him around and about, and every time it kind of bums her out, which is kind of understandable. So you see an ex, and you're thinking, now my day isn't all that great. But then I like her positive self-talk, because she says to herself, but don't react now. You can't go back now. Don't panic, Mutya. Just look ahead now. So that's some really good positive self-talk.
It is positive self-talk, but she's had 17 months to process all of this.
It's just that it's a year and a half.
Mm.
So it's a lot of positive self-talk, and I respect that, and I think that's a good thing to do. So she sees him at the red light with his new woman.
Ouch.
But then she's going out to lunch with one of her friends.
Mm.
And it seems like they're in a restaurant or somewhere.
Mm.
And she says, I'm feeling on top of the world, but I've got a hunch. And there the girl is again. She sat right behind her back, and it seems like the ex-boyfriend and her are having lunch right next to where Mutya and her friend are having lunch. So what are the odds?
I mean,
do these people live in Hollyoaks Village where everybody bumps into each other on a daily basis? What is that about? Do you live in London? I mean, she seems like a London girl. She's got a London accent.
Mm.
And where are you that you keep bumping into this guy?
And even if she does live in London, there's also possibly, there may possibly be a case of stalking.
Is he stalking her? Dragging this new woman around to follow around his ex? In which case, then I would worry for the new woman, because this guy sounds like a psycho.
Is he trying to lord it over her?
Trying to parade his new love?
Mm. Which is a bit disturbing.
And then it becomes disturbing. So,
or is the protagonist, is Mutya possibly stalking him, that she is aware of where they are going?
No, see, I would disagree with that.
And takes her girlfriend there.
Because she seems kind of shocked, like, I'm on top of the world, and oh, there he is.
Right.
So I don't think she's I think she's trying to get away from him.
Right.
But they've bumped into each other twice now, just in this song. And, you know, he's going to get another girlfriend, girl.
She doesn't,
and,
yeah, I think, you know, which is understandable. As you said earlier, you know, you can't expect him to become a monk. That said, perhaps she's struggling with the notion that she's been replaced. She maybe just wanted him just to feel as tortured as she clearly is.
Well, see, that just makes me want to call her up and say, girl, you and me are going out on the town and we are going to find you a man.
Mm.
Even if it's just like a one night stand, it might make her feel better.
Yeah.
Like, it's just, you're going to grab some hunky guy on the dance floor. And if you're both up for it, then that might make her, I just really feel like she needs to get over this guy. He's not good enough for you, girlfriend. He's not good enough.
Mm.
White people can't say girlfriend like that, can they?
You just did.
I know, and it's bad.
Girlfriend.
Yeah, like when I'm watching Orange is the New Black, I find myself like saying things that don't sound good in, like, you know, unless you're kind of a Latina or, you know, it just sounds like not good. I'm struggling to think of it.
I'd love to think of an example.
Come on, Dukey, you're watching, you know, we're both texting each other while we're watching season 7, right?
We are. However, this puts me into a bit of a corner, because if I start to use some of them, I'm going to sound well dodge.
Yeah, you're going to sound really dodgy, right? So, yeah, I mean, it just can't. There's just some things that Latina women can say that maybe should be left.
I believe that Mutya or Mutya, as she refers to herself in the song, is of part Filipino extraction.
Is she? Oh, I never knew that. I always thought that she's got an unusual name that I've never come across before. But I couldn't really quite get to grips with what maybe her cultural heritage was.
Part Filipino.
Oh, she's Filipino.
Is definitely in her DNA makeup.
Buena is her last name.
I believe that is probably a Tagalog Filipino surname.
Ah, very good. Well, I just, Dukey, I don't know what you think, but I think the song is a bit of a mixture. And you know, which one of us can't relate, where you're going along about your day and maybe you might be thinking to yourself, I feel pretty good. I feel pretty good today. I'm having a good day. You know, the sun is shining. Maybe I don't have any work on, and that's a good thing.
You're listening to Prince.
And all of a sudden, something happens that's just like the life version of like a bird shitting on you in that moment. Like you get a letter.
Yes.
Or you get an email.
Yes.
Or you get a text.
You've all been there.
And, or you see somebody and you just think, eh, shit.
Yeah.
You know, kind of like that. And you just think, there I was going about my life, just kind of having a nice day. And this shit happens, and now I'm kind of bummed out. It's kind of, I guess, to sum up this whole song, it's the ultimate buzzkill song.
Yes. I really feel for her.
She's had her buzz massively killed. And I just want to say to her, please, Mutya, keep up with the positive self-talk, because
indeed,
I think that is a really, really smart thing to do.
And the safe driving.
I think you're doing really good, girl. I think you're wonderful. I think you're sexy. I think you're sassy. I think you're amazing. I think you're really talented. I think your solo career should have gone a lot better than it did. And I think, girl, he's out there waiting for you somewhere, and he's a much better guy than this asshole is, who's following you around town with his new girlfriend. He's out there, honey, and you go get him.
The sad reality is her ex has clearly moved on.
Yes.
And she needs to move on as well.
But keep up with that positive self-talk.
And I have an update. She appeared, Ms. Buena, that is, in Celebrities Go Dating Celebrities. What's that?
Yes, I think I saw like a trailer for that
or
something.
In a dating program for celebrities.
Yes.
And Celebrity First Dates.
Oh, yes.
And obviously, this is in the last year. You'd mentioned that this track that we were analysing today came out 12 or so years ago.
I think so, yes.
So
so she's trying to move on.
Absolutely.
Well, I would hope so after 12 years. I mean, my gosh. Well,
indeed.
17 months is long enough to be kind of telling yourself, you know, I don't want to be so cut up every time I come across this guy or think about this guy. But 12 years, and she's, you know, she's out there on the dating scene, you know, good for her. And keep up with that positive self-talk, because I think that's a really good thing to do.
And the safe driving.
And
well, I'm really excited about the Sugababes reunion.
Dukey, I'm far more excited than I probably should be, because I don't know what their demographic is, but I'm probably pretty sure that I'm not it.
I disagree.
Well, who is their demographic?
People who like great pop.
Oh, is it? Okay. So, yeah, I mean, I was around when they first came out,
indeed,
and I thought they were great, and I think they're great now, and I think they're amazing, and I love them. And, Dukey, if you get tickets to go see them, I am your plus one for sure.
That goes without saying. Well, that is indeed your lot. I will never, ever be baffled by oral hygiene options again. You've been listening to Oral Hygiene. My name is Dukey and I've been your host. Until next time, may the worst of tomorrow be the best of yesterday. Now it's time for me to go and attempt to whiten my teeth. Wish me luck. And after I'm done with that, I'm definitely going to go and pop my weasel. Thanks for listening.
Half a pound of tuppenny rice, half a pound of treacle. That's the way the money goes. Pop goes the weasel.
Facebook. Click on your mouse to our Facebook page. Facebook. It's easy to find, it will not take an age. Facebook. www.facebook.com/ The Dukey Radio Show, The Dukey Radio Show.
The thin white Dukey is right. Click your way to the Dukey Radio Show Facebook page, www.facebook.com/ The Dukey Radio Show.
The Dukey Radio Show, The Dukey Radio Show.
Next time on The Dukey Radio Show, Marsha gets quite the shock while getting coffee.
They have what on the menu?
And discovers an apparatus that will change her life.
Oh my God, I think this apparatus is going to change my life.
Apparatus and the use of 17 as an age in popular music comes in for a fair bit of stick.
He's only 17. Ew.
Ew.
You're gone now, I feel fine. 17 months, yeah, I feel fine. What about you? I bet you've been crying. Bet you've been going round town lying. Yeah. I'm driving bows, I feel so fine. I've got Prince singing up and to me. I know every line. So I pulled up to the red light, sitting here in me car. I look up to me right, and there you is, sat there with some new girl. What is this? Don't panic, panic, hurry, don't drive erratic. That's who has replaced me, what a thief. Don't panic, panic, don't act too manic, manic. It's a surefire way to ruin me day. Just as soon as I'm on top of me life, there you is again. But don't react now, you can't go back now. Don't panic, panic, Irene. Just look ahead now.